We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to See It Clearly. I'm your host, Michael Carson, and today we've got a really wonderful guest. It's a guest that, well, we see a lot of things eye to eye. We've been working together, but apart for many years on trying to save ourselves and the world. It's G. Brian Benson is here to join us today. How you doing?
I'm great. Thanks, Michael.
Good, good. We're going to get right to the interview, but just want to remind you that today's show is brought to you by Fit in Seconds. We're going to talk a little bit about Fit in Seconds after the first break, but if you go to fitinseconds.com, it's the first pre-meal workout that you can do that's only 90 seconds in length that you do before each meal. It'll help you lose between 1 and 3 ounces of fat, actually, every time that you do this routine. So you go to fitinseconds.com. I'll give you a little bit more info after the first break. But before we get started, we were talking just a moment ago about El Chapo. And now, we're motivated people. Now, that is a motivated man. I mean,
absolutely.
I mean, the guy is imprisoned. I mean, he's in a Mexican prison. And like I said to you off air, maybe it couldn't happen in the United States, but guys with no cartels behind them got out in New York. They were captured, though. What do you think El Chapo's chances are?
He's probably, I don't know if he's going to get caught.
I don't think he is. I think that he is going to have, or already is having, surgical procedures done to change who he is.
Ooh, I never thought about that.
Yeah, and you know, and I think he may have changed his name to the Spanish version of Caitlin. So, and he'll be very hard to find because he'll be in six-inch heels and... No, that's bad. Sorry.
Oh, well.
I digress.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, let's get back. G. Brian Benson is an author. He is a actor. You are a producer, a writer, a father, a motivator. What I like to refer to you as a one-man machine of motivation.
Wow.
I know. That's a lot to live up to.
Yeah.
But you just did something this weekend that you finished off. We had it on the flyer for the show. You were in a play. Tell me a little bit how that went.
I think it went really well. I learned so much. It was my first play, and it was really wonderful. It was... There was a series of 5 one-act plays, and I was in the play called Bones, and it was it's really well written. It was written by a man named Javon Jones, and he's from Chicago. And it basically our scene happened in about 1930, and it was between myself and another man who very heavy scene where I was with his daughter when she was killed about 30 years before.
Oh wow, that is heavy.
Yeah, murdered, and I couldn't do anything to, you know, help, and so I kind of carried that guilt around with me until I went looking for him 30 years later and ended up killing the 3 people that killed her.
Wow.
and kind of brought him
some justice,
yeah, and you know, to try as well as relieve some of my own pain that I'd been carrying. And so it was a wonderful experience, you know. I think I wish we could keep doing it. It was only for 3 nights. Because the third night was like the first time I really started having fun with it. I was so nervous the first two.
I can imagine. And they don't know about this, but this is your first play, and you often, and more likely than not, are always looking for something to put you outside of your comfort zone and trying something new, and this is huge.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, so, you know, I'm very proud of the fact that I said yes and went after it and did it. And I learned a lot of great lessons from it, and I'll definitely move forward with a lot more confidence.
Would you do more plays?
I definitely think I'll do another play, absolutely. You know, I'm not quite sure when, but yeah, I'm open to that, absolutely.
Yeah, because I know you've done a lot of production, and in doing the film, we'll talk more about your films in a while, but the chance to get a second take, what a luxury that is, you know?
Yeah.
And when you're on stage, you're
it's totally
like you said
different.
The first couple nights, were you inside your head while you were acting the first couple of nights? Because I've found that when I've been on stage, sometimes you're not fully present until you really own it.
Right. You know, that's interesting. The first night, I felt like I really connected well with my scene partner. The second night, I had some friends show up and a couple people that I really wanted to do well for, and I felt like I was in my head for that, and so I didn't feel as strong about that performance. But the third night, I was definitely really connected again, and so, yeah, you know, it's an interesting process. I think in a play, and anybody who's been in one or does it a lot, you know, you just, the main difference for me or for what I've learned so far is you're just, there's such a long, you know, you're just totally connected for such a long period of time. Whereas, you know, in film and TV, it's just, you know, a little brief blip moments.
Yeah, and, I mean, you really have to, because the cameras change and they give us a new energized perspective of the scene. Yeah, you don't get that when you're in a play.
No, I mean, yeah, I mean, you know, on a TV or film, you're having to do the same scene 3 or 4 or 5 times from a different angle, you know, maybe 10 times altogether because you do it a couple times from each one, yeah, what have you. And
rehearsals.
So just the high that you get and the feeling of being alive is I think, magnified for sure.
I performed on stage a little bit, not as much as I probably would have liked to, but LA is a harder place to perform on stage. People are, it's harder to get people to show up.
That's what I've heard, yeah. We were really lucky. We had a nice house all three times.
That's
all
good.
Three nights, yeah.
That's good, because that makes a big difference, too. When there's energy in the house, you go,
definitely.
Wow, I got to rise to this occasion.
Exactly. It really does make a difference.
Yeah, well, one other thing you've done, and this was just recently on May 30th, was you gave a TEDx talk.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never given one.
I've
watched a lot. No, not yet. And I would really, really, it's interesting to me. Take me inside that experience, if you would.
You know, that was just another thing that really was a wonderful experience for me, too. You know, I had to prepare for both of them quite a bit. You know, obviously, the TEDx talk, I found out about 3 months before that I was going to be in the lineup. And so, you know, I crafted my piece, and
because it's a time.
Yeah, you have up to 18 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, I really set goals to like maybe get the piece written in about, you know, a month or 6 weeks. I really wanted to give myself a lot of time to ease into giving it, you know, not feel rushed as I was trying to memorize it and make it a part of me.
Right.
So I everything went really well, and you know, it's just a very surreal experience. We had a rehearsal, I think the couple days before, and that
was an audience, or
well, you know, people walking around and stuff, and you know, but it
was in the
venue on the stage, and not with the lights, but it was helpful getting that one out of the way. And then the day of, you know, it turned out really well. I just, all you can really do in whether it's a play or a TEDx talk or anything, you know, an Ironman, you name it, you just gotta kind of walk forward and trust. And you know, you have to prepare for it, but you just gotta believe that you can do it before you do it, and just trust that it's going to be okay.
And not over-prepare for it.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. You know, getting your head too much or what have you. Right. There's all kinds of different ways we can over-prepare.
Yeah.
So the TEDx talk was awesome, and I gained a lot of confidence from that, too.
Now, you covered a lot of topics, you told me, in the TEDx talk. And
yeah.
You know, let's go over a couple of those, because they're part of who you really are. And,
sure.
And then I want to talk about some of those ultra-endurance racing things that you did, because that's exciting.
Of course. Yeah. So the talk itself was called Be Yourself to Free Yourself, How to Find Your Personal Freedom. And so what I basically did was talked about my journey the last 6 years from when I left my family business into the unknown. And I kind of just told my story chronologically and a lot of the different things that have happened to me, but I explained them with some of the lessons that I learned. And I had 5 points that I kind of had the story weave through. And the first point was follow your intuition and be open to whatever comes your way. Number 2 was step out of your comfort zone. 3 was stay in life balance. 4 was have fun and enjoy the ride. And 5 was there are no rules, expect the unexpected. And so I just, you know, I'm really happy how it turned out. I can't wait for the video to come out so I can share it.
Now, stay in life balance.
Mm-hmm.
The other 4, I probably do those pretty well myself. Stay in life balance. What does that mean to you? And give an example of what that would be.
Well, there's a lot of things that I do to stay in balance, and I think, you know, for me, I love to go hike.
Mm-hmm.
Eating well works for me. You know, getting enough sleep. Connecting with other positive, creative people.
So when you feel out of balance, you kind of look to those things that you just mentioned as your main pillars.
Yeah,
maybe they're out of joint. They're not in the right.
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of things I think, you know, and if you know, we go over some of my book. There's a lot of different things we can do. But for me, I have some main pillars that really help me kind of, just carry me through For sure.
And reset you in a positive way.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I have to do that.
It's funny you mentioned food, too, because I mentioned on the radio, and I'll do it again here, that Mrs. Winston's is a supermarket in Santa Monica that has an unbelievable buffet.
I live in the Valley, so I don't know where that is. Yeah.
I'm sure you have similar. It takes Whole Foods to the next level as far as the buffet is concerned.
Okay.
And every time I eat there and finish, I just feel like I've got rocket fuel in my body. And so,
nice.
Sometimes you need to eat really healthy, just a couple meals to reset yourself.
Totally. Oh, absolutely. I got a Vitamix about 5 years ago, and that was the best investment I ever made. I wake up every day, and I just throw a bunch of vegetables in there and gag it down.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It used to be fruit, right? Now vegetables are the thing. Fruit's almost too sweet sometimes. It's like just too much. But let's talk about this first book.
Yeah.
This is not your brand new book, but this has been around for a while.
Yes.
And we talked about, books don't go out of style that really makes sense. And this one does, Brian's List, which is something that, tell us about the beginning of when you started making this list of things and what the list means.
So. Sure. Well, basically, the book came through me unexpectedly. I was running my family's business in Salem, Oregon. We had a golf center, driving range, retail store, and a 9-hole par 3 course, Salem, Oregon. And I'd been running it for 11 years, and I just was starting to feel really burned out and like I was supposed to do something else with my life, although I had no idea what it was going to be. And I told my dad, I think I'm done. And and he was very understanding. So, but it took a year from that discussion to actually leave because he decided to sell it. And so, there was that process of listing it and finding a buyer.
Based on your decision, too?
Mm-hmm, based on my decision.
Wow. So
yeah.
So you put the family in a whole different trajectory there.
Well, yeah. I mean, he had another business, and I basically ran the golf center, but we made decisions together. But he was all right, with it. And so I started to become really out of balance maybe the last 6 months that I was there that last year because I just was so ready to begin the rest of my life, although I had no idea what I was going to do. And it got to the point where I just sat myself down and decided to come up with a handful of things that I knew that would help keep me in balance. And I think my original list was like, make sure I was drinking enough water, make sure that I was having some daily exercise.
Did you write this list?
Mm-hmm.
This was written.
Just a little index card.
So for all of you people that are under the age of 40 that don't have a pencil and piece of paper.
I'm a list guy.
Yeah, the list, there's something about creating that list that's more ingrained.
Yeah.
You can't delete a pencil list.
Well, and it frees your brain up too because, whether it's a to-do list or whatever, if you put it on paper and then you can just kind of look at it from a different perspective too. But the last two things were make sure that I was allowing myself to have some alone time every day, some quiet time, because that's how I regenerated. I'm a bit of an introvert. And finally, to make sure that I was being creative every day. And at that point in my life, playing my guitar was a creative outlet. So I just did that, and it really helped me. And I just intuitively felt like I was supposed to expand the list, and I did. And I wrote the book in about a month.
Now, it's 26 and a half?
Yeah.
What's
I had 25. I thought of another one I knew I needed to add, and some of my friends were saying, it needs to be an even number. I'm going to make it really weird, so I just added the half, and the half is just another chapter just on a whole bunch of different other things that I didn't really write about in depth like I did.
Yeah, I should give you some suggestions for things.
Some suggestions.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah, so, it was just an unexpected little joy for me to have this happen, and so
Well, and a lot of people have books
self-published
in their living room and in their restroom, and I think that this is one of those books that you want to have lying around so when people come over they can just open it up. It's like I'm just going to open up to a random page and let's see what we
I mean it's very
with.
Simple. Everything's just a couple pages.
And the thing, and you probably can't see it on the camera, is every one of the chapters has a photograph, not a photograph,
a drawing,
a caricature of you from Laura Schofield. And she never actually met you, but she really captured the essence of you in all these photos.
Yeah,
it's
thanks.
It's pretty interesting.
Yeah, it just makes it fun in a different way,
Well, it makes it so, it really is Brian's list. It's not just a list of random motivational things that people compiled from around the world. And I think that's why I like it a lot, because it's coming from the reality of you trying to improve yourself. And I think that you do similar to I, that when you're helping other people, it actually motivates you to keep helping yourself. Because we have to be a good example.
Right.
We can't set an example and then not continue it on. So
exactly.
You know, and one of the other things that you have in one of these chapters is removing clutter from your life. And that is a huge thing I try and get people to do. They think that when you come home and you put things down in your home and everything's not put away, that they're relaxing, but they're not. You know, explain how your brain gets a little bit cluttered up too.
I don't know exactly scientifically, but I, you know, it's just kind of like a subconscious weight that yeah. just, you know, it could be the same with like a dirty house too.
It's been proven scientifically that it does make you
feel a little more anxious
and less organized and less capable of attacking what's going on now.
I like it. No, I agree. I intuitively felt that, and so I included it. Yes.
Now, how old were you when you started the list?
Let's see. I would have been 43 then.
Oh wow! Yeah. So this is pretty recent.
Yeah.
That's fantastic because yeah. it's not one of those things where it's not coming from a 22-year-old kid. It's coming from someone who's gone through life and yeah. realized that these things, if I eliminate them, my life isn't as good or as productive or as full of energy and love.
Well, it was a very interesting time for me. I mean, here I was leaving something, the only thing that I really knew, you know, work-wise, but yet it wasn't really making me fulfilled. Mm. And so I just was stepping out into the unknown, and I was, you know, I gobbled up, you know, some other self-help books, and I just kind of was in that mode of trying to give myself as strong a foundation as I could as I headed off into the second half of my life.
Did you ever do any of the, I did a Tony Robbins, I did the Fire Walk Weekend. Mm-hmm. Did you ever do any of those?
No, but I think in some ways some of the things I did earlier in my life, like the Iron Man and riding my bike across yeah. the country, were kind of my own version of that.
Right, and that's good. That's something that I wanted to bring up. And you were, I didn't realize you were so young when you did those things. You were in your 20s when you
early
did those.
Early 20s, yeah, when I started doing them, yeah.
Yeah. So tell us about that, because Iron Man, I was an ultra endurance athlete, so this is interesting to me. So what got you involved in that? What was your first thing that you did?
Well, the thing that really got me into triathlons, when I was in college, I was playing mud football with a bunch of my friends, and my kneecap got knocked out of place.
Ooh.
It was nasty, and I ended up having to have surgery, rehabbed it, started getting in shape, felt good, and a couple of my buddies had done a couple short triathlons, and this is like 1986 or 7, kind of still when triathlon was very new.
It was very new.
And so I thought that would be a good little thing
challenge
to shoot for. Yeah. You know, after I got myself, my knee healthy again. And so I did a short one in the summer of 87. Loved it. Really gave me a lot of empowerment. And I ended up doing 4 more that summer. And I think the next year I did 10. And in 89, my third year in triathlons, I did my first Ironman.
Wow.
Up in Canada.
And tell the people that don't know Ironman the distances that you have to cover.
Yeah, in an Ironman, it's a 2.4-mile swim, cold water swim.
Yeah.
Well, it depends on where you're at. And then a 112-mile bike, and then a marathon, 26-mile run.
Not so much. Not a problem there, right?
It's crazy.
You might want to have a breakfast.
Yeah, yeah. And some snacks along the way.
Yeah. So in the swimming part, you did pretty well in the swim, didn't you?
Yeah. Swimming and cycling were my strengths.
Swimming is the hardest part, I think, for most people. And for you to get the swimming, that gives you an edge.
Yeah. You know, when I was at Oregon State, as I started to get into triathlons, the women had a funded swim team program where the men just had a club team. Mm. But they traveled together. I just jumped out of my comfort zone there and just joined the men's swim club and got my butt kicked,
yeah,
really kicked at a lot of the meets. But all I did was freestyle, but it made me really improve, and I became a really good triathlon swimmer.
Yeah, because that's the thing about triathlons. It's not about the person who's the fastest at one event. It's the one who's most consistent throughout all three.
Right, and yeah. Swimming is a very short period of time in the whole scheme of that race. But, you know, it was
yeah, 2.4 miles is no joke, though. I mean,
it's a long ways, but I mean, an actual time chunk out of that race. Yeah. It's a small portion, but
I think that most, a lot of people drop out during that section, though, unfortunately, due to injury, and they get overwhelmed. You know, it's different when you get in the water with hundreds of people at the same time.
I got a story about that.
Okay.
Oh, boy. In flash forward to 2006, my last Ironman in Arizona, I had a panic attack in the water right at the start. I mean, there's like, you know, 2,300 other people, right?
Is
in the
that
exact
many?
Yeah, it was like a big piranha feeding frenzy.
I thought it was like 400 or 500. I didn't know it was that big.
No, a lot. And I'm a good swimmer, and all of a sudden I just started hyperventilating, and I had to go over to the side and hang on for a couple minutes and regain my composure. It was crazy. I just caught me out of the
Now, blue. Are you in a half suit or a full wetsuit when you do these? Or
I'm full with sleeveless, you know, sleeveless,
yeah,
full.
Because the water in it was Hawaii, right?
No, the one, well, I did Canada twice. I did
Up
in,
my God, that's cold.
It was a little colder. And then Phoenix was, it was a hot day. It was 97 degrees that day, but the water was fine.
What kind, where was it, Lake Powell?
It was in Tempe Town Lake, which is right next to Arizona Sun Devil Stadium. It was, it's not opened to people except for that once a year, so you get out with a sore throat.
there's no, oh, yeah, it's all the air conditioning. And there's no...
Or just it's dirty water. It's like a little canal that's...
Oh, God, but there's no waves, so that must be very...
Well,
it's weird. It's
except
like
for all
a,
the swimmers.
It's like a fishery.
No, it really was. It's like a feeding frenzy at the start.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Wow. So... If it's okay to ask, what's the best time that you got?
I think a little over 12 hours. It was like 12 hours and 14 minutes.
Yeah. And if you think like I do, which it sounds like you have similar, that's a 12-hour vacation away from the phone, the email, anybody that can bother you. It's just, it's all about pulling yourself to the end. It's not even pushing, it's pulling. You know, I guess you want to get there.
It's hard to explain, but I... You know, I'd have to think about it a little more, but I probably had maybe 5, 6, 7 times in my life where I really felt alive, and those were some of them.
I understand what you mean. I mean, when I was doing some of the race, there were a few moments that you just go, I'm never going to forget this moment, I don't think you think at the moment, I don't know if it gets any better than this, but it doesn't really get any better than that, than to feel that empowerment when you're in nature.
You're totally present.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe that's why I feel that way, because I was totally focused on the moment and present, and it's hard to do on a consistent basis.
I mean, that's what we're all searching for, to try to do, you know, in real life, is just to try to stay present.
Yeah, I mean, there are Tibetan monks that are still trying, and they don't even... have the distractions. They don't allow the distractions we have, and daily they're work. Have you been to that part of the world?
No.
That'd be something that I think eventually I'd like to do, but I think I need to be a little bit more educated to what they are all about. You know, I know a little bit about it, but I wouldn't want to go over there and be a looky-loo.
Right.
Can I take a selfie with you? Do you know the llama? I want to meet the llama. Not even Fernando Lama. Well, we're going to about take a break in a minute, but before we do, I want to talk a little bit more about Brian's list, because we're going to come back and talk about the other book that you have. Mm-hmm. Now, where can you find this?
Amazon.
Amazon.com?
Yeah, and you can also get it through me on my website.
Oh, and gbrianbenson.com, and that's G-Brian Benson without a period between the G and the Brian.
Yep.
Brian.com. And it was a winner of the Next Generation Indie Book Awards, and that was that's fantastic.
Thank you. Yeah, it was just a pinch me moment. You know, I was just totally wide open to the world at that point in my life, and for some direction, and it just kind of, that book is kind of what just kind of pointed me heading off into this journey that I'm on now, and acting, and you name it. I mean, it's just, yeah.
And I think it's a great one to pick up if your kids just graduated from high school or college, or it's a great summer book just to sit and read, and not, because in the summer, we don't want to focus on a real intense thing, but you'd be so shocked at what this does to direct you intensely in the right direction. So it's soft selling much better mental and physical and just emotional health, I think.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're sharing it. I loved it, and I keep it in my living room now because I want people to look at it. And just if you do one or two pages a day, by the end of a month, you've got an entire new list of things you may have tried before and may have forgotten, because there were a few in there that I had forgotten. But
or just different ways to look at the world.
Yeah.
In
a gentle way.
In a gentle way.
We're always looking at trying to not... We are. I shouldn't say that as the overall we, but the planet seems to be always just looking to try and get ahead, and to get over on, and to get more of, or to escape from jail, or try to become president.
But the most amazing thing is when we take a step back and we kind of initially feel like it's less, but it's actually more, and that's when stuff really starts to happen.
Yeah, I agree.
It's allowance instead of pushing.
Yeah, when you let yourself feel. We're going to take a little break here. This is Corner Bar with Uncle Cracker. You're listening to during the break. But we're going to come right back with G. Brian Benson, and you're going to go to www.gbrianbenson.com to hear a little bit more about this book and the other book that we're going to talk about, Finding Your Voice. And we're going to talk more about fitness, motivation, and life. We'll be right back. This is See It Clearly. I'm your host, Michael Carson.
In the land lawyers, guns, and money. A funny little thing we all call greed brought my hometown down to its knees. A little bit worried about the shape I'm in. Baby needs shoes and the wallet's thin. Got no gas or electricity, but everybody's singing in harmony. Sell me up.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
NOMA, the National Organization of Minority Architects Youth Summer Camp, consists of field trips to iconic architectural complexes. Join us for 3 days of hands-on building design learning experiences. To register, go to SoCalNOMA.org. That's SoCalNOMA.org.
I lost 4.5 inches on my weight. I went down 2 loops on my belt. I've lost 10 pounds.
Hi, I'm Michael Carson, America's fitness coach, here to teach you how to burn body fat with every meal in only seconds a day. Fit in Seconds is a video workout program designed to accelerate your metabolism, resulting in burning fat with every meal. My Fit in Seconds video workouts will train your metabolism to use food as fuel, not as storage.
With Fit in Seconds, I lost 27 pounds and 5 inches off my waistline.
It's time to get fit in seconds.
Hubert's Lemonade, tasty, refreshing, sweet, and tart. Happiness in a bottle. Visit Hubert's Lemonade at hubertslemonade.com. Once again, that's hubertslemonade.com. Happiness in a bottle.
You ain't got no kind of feeling inside, yeah.
Welcome back to See It Clearly. I'm your host, Michael Carson. We're joined today by G. Brian Benson. John, thank you very much for being back here with me.
Thank you very much.
And as we left, we were talking about your book. But after you were completed with your book, you had a new desire to learn even more and to put yourself into an even more uncomfortable zone. And
yeah,
you got into acting, and you have this this movie short called Guitar Man.
Uh-huh.
And tell me how, before you got into Guitar Man, what made you end up into the acting platform and world?
Sure. It was kind of a surprise too. You know, after my Brian's List came out, I just kind of felt like I would need to learn how to be comfortable in front of people to, whether, you know, talk about this potentially or what have you. And so mm-hmm. It was very scary for me because I'm kind of an outgoing introvert, but the last thing I wanted to do at that point in my life was talk, you know, speech, you name it. So I started the process of did a couple of speech classes at, you know, community colleges. I joined Toastmasters for a while. I co-hosted my own internet radio show for a while. I created a workshop. I ended up taking an acting class, a beginning acting class in Reno, Nevada, because I thought that'd be another tool as well. And I found out I really kind of enjoyed it, and it was kind of healing in a weird way for me. And so I met a young filmmaker, little bit after that, and I had an idea for Guitar Man just kind of come to me in the middle of a dream one night. I woke up, wrote it down, gave him a call a couple of days later and asked if he wanted to hear a potential idea for a short film, and he said yeah. So we got together, he loved it, and like no more than 2 weeks after that, we found ourselves on the streets of Reno, Nevada, over the course of maybe 3 or 4 nights, and did Guitar Man. And you know, I kind of, if you watch it, it's on my website. It's kind of a narrative, but yet we incorporated a lot of the folks that are in that movie that we just found on the streets.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you got real raw talent.
There's some, yeah, absolutely. And so it was just a really wonderful experience. I mean, I'd never acted before. I'd never really written anything like that before. And, you know, with Michael's help, the cameraman and director, it just we made it happen, and it was such an empowering experience. And the film ended up getting accepted to like 11 film festivals, and it just woke me up to a whole nother potential creative outlet and another way to put out some positive material, you know what I mean, because there's a lot of good messages in it. And you know, somebody saw that and gave me the lead in their short film, which hasn't been released yet, but I met some people there that were instrumental and that kind of got me here a couple of years ago, and it's just been really a wonderful experience the last 2 years.
And that one that's Cindy releases, Searching for Happiness, that's the one you're talking about, or is that a different one?
Let's see, searching.
Finding. Searching for Happiness is a...
Oh, yes. The other one that I was in is called Seasons for Life, and it has not been released.
Seasons, so it's got two that we're looking forward to coming out.
Yes, but Searching for Happiness is my film. The other one was not mine, I just acted in it. So yeah, Searching for Happiness is mine that I wrote, and I'm really excited about it. It's kind of unique. And
what's it about?
Without
can you or just give away too much?
Without spilling too much, it's about somebody who's not happy, but he ends up kind of learning the true meaning of it, mm-hmm. and it's done in kind of a unique way without any dialogue.
Oh, interesting.
And some colorization with black and white and stuff. So, yeah.
Oh, so it's very creative.
Yeah, yeah. It has a great score. A young man named Toby Sheriff, who's in the USC Film and TV Scoring Program, master's program there, did it for me. And, yeah.
Well, it's very interesting to me because a lot of, and I've been in Los Angeles, you know, you said you did these things, and they were all in Reno when you were taking these courses in
mm-hmm.
Toastmaster.
Yeah.
And,
mm-hmm.
People come to L.A. and they'll maybe dabble in one or two acting classes at all,
yeah.
if any. And they want their looks and their presence in their former hometown to propel them to a place where they have acting and broadcast roles. But you took the bull by the horn and taught yourself how to do it, so you actually have a career now where you see a lot of the people that just, they come out here and they play act. They play that they want to produce something. They play they want to write and create something. But you took all the steps, and I think that more than just your book of motivation, it shows people that the steps you need to take are more crucial than just saying, I'm an actor, I'm going to be a producer. You got to take those steps.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I came here with a pretty solid foundation. I mean, this was all new to me, but yet, you know, I'd already had the books under me and, you know, some acting. And
just L.A.
you know,
was new, not the...
L.A. was new, right, yeah. You know, but believe me, I mean, it's ever since I got here, I've been, you know, studying and working very hard, and, mm-hmm. and I've been part of some really amazing projects. A couple of short films I was in were recently accepted to the Cannes Film Festival in the shorts category. And so I just... Everybody I connect with has just been awesome and creative and positive and, you know, it just builds.
Yeah. Yeah. And especially when you're giving into something positive and you get something back from people, it just builds because they're going to work with you again.
Exactly.
And that's how LA is, that people, they get a job and they become a prima donna almost immediately. You've seen it. You've been on sets even in these small films where people are like, you're like, really? Are you kidding me? You know, this is an opportunity that without this, you won't even have something to show to get a real agent because, you know, out here, an agent wants you to be able to make them money, not them make you money.
Right.
It's like, really, you want to be, well, kid, what have you got underneath your belt? It's like, well,
yeah,
I'm trying to own a belt. Can you help me buy a belt? Like, well, come back when you got a belt and some suspenders and we'll take care of you.
Yeah, you know, it's a process and you have to learn kind of how things work, you know, and as well as just do the work.
Because we have a lot of life coaches that come
mm-hmm,
on the show.
Mm-hmm.
And the information they give is very valuable in life altogether. But what you're doing, you could actually mentor people in being creative and using their brains for creative endeavors as opposed to just working hard. Because you've taken the road that you're taking is because you're doing it in all directions. You've done radio, you've done television, you're doing film, you're doing plays, you're writing books. Can you fly?
Yeah,
I know Heroes.
I'm working on it.
Heroes Redo is coming out. Are you going to be on that show?
Sure, I'd love to.
Yeah, you flew here. Boy, my arms are tired.
Yeah.
But your other book that you have is called Finding Your Voice.
Yeah.
And different than Brian's list. Brian's list is, and this is from my perspective, and you correct me, but just as a reader, it's a list of great ideas that you can grasp onto improve your daily and overall life.
Exactly.
And Finding Your Voice, I feel,
it's more
is
personal.
More personal and lessons of life that will give you a perspective viewing after something may have occurred and to give you a path to follow, not just a small item to attach onto.
No, that's a great description of the two. Yeah, Brian's list is just, it's a little more, it's all very valuable and there's some depth to it, but Finding Your Voice is a lot deeper, and it's more my personal, you know, stuff. There's a lot of you know, little short stories in there. There's some inspirational poetry. There's some quotes. There's just, it's basically my, you know, a capsule of some of my journey the last few years.
And the quotes and the poems they're very nice. You know,
thank you.
You know, it's something that you wouldn't think that you've written them all. You know, because some of them there's a throwback feel to them that they may have come from the 1800s and 1900s.
Oh, wow.
And that's a good feeling. I mean, it's about, you know, like Thomas Jefferson said some things that now you go, oh my God, that means exactly what it meant then today. And that's really good. Your books are not flash in the pan. You know, you see some of these books that come out, and it's about this time of the world that's right now that we can grasp onto, and mm-hmm. maybe we can embrace it and enjoy the Twitter feeds of the world. This is about really foundationally improving who you are through exploring yourself and not being afraid to look at yourself. People are really afraid to look at themselves. Only visually will they look at themselves.
Thank you for the compliment. You know, I'm really trying to be the best version of myself, and I still make mistakes, but I'm working on it, and I really pay a lot of attention, you know what I mean, to what's going on, what I'm thinking, where I'm headed and all that. And so, you know, thank you. Yeah, I feel like as I work on becoming the best version of myself, I can hopefully help or inspire somebody else, because we're all very similar. You know, we're all going through the same things in just little different ways. And, you know, if I can do it.
I've always been someone who's admitted when I make a mistake. And I find that so many people are so unable to admit they made a mistake because they feel it weakens them or puts them in a position that you're more powerful than them, and whatever it is psychologically.
Right.
Why can't we admit a mistake, even though we know in our soul? I mean, we know when we're just denying the fact that we did that and we're not going to accept it. You know? So I think a lot of times people need to start right from even in traffic. You know, if you made a mistake or someone, rather than flipping them off in a response, maybe just say, hey, sorry, and stop the... Because I find that the aggression in driving around L.A. is much different than even in Reno. Even though people may have lost a lot of money at the casino,
this is unlike anywhere else, yeah.
Yeah, it's dangerous. So if we're able to change that mistake fear of being something, that's okay, I made a mistake, you know, I cut you off, and hey, sorry, dude. You know, and I'm much better at it than I used to be.
Me too.
Yeah, and it's something that doesn't feel good when you don't deny your authentic truth.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know something? I mean, if you just, for those of us who live in L.A., you know, when you're driving out on the freeway next time, just let a couple people in and just see how that feels compared to, like, you know, trying to be competitive with them and, like, not... Yeah. It's hard to explain, but it's just so silly.
And they're right behind you now.
I know, big deal.
Pissed off.
Right. Yeah.
And
it affects us too.
It affects every lane, and you know, they begin to speed up, then that person's speeding up, and it's like
a good old ego.
Yeah, it's a frenzy of egos that just start to, you know, domino effect down the 405 freeway.
Yeah.
And I think the hardest part of LA is we have to travel. I mean, there's really no way that we can get around it. You can't just... I mean, we can Skype and do things on the phone, but in order to be person to person, to act in something, to rehearse, you got to be there.
Absolutely.
And then you'll fight to traffic from Studio City down to wherever your rehearsal hall is, and you get there shaking like a leaf. You've used almost all your energy. You need food before you can even act. So it's like,
I know.
LA is in New York City. I imagine has got to be similar too, because you're just the constant.
It makes you a little hard.
It does.
And my son noticed that when he visited me not too long ago. I mean, not that I'm, you know, but it does make you
noticed
a little bit, yeah.
Yeah. What was the thing?
I think we were driving or something. Yeah.
I find that I'm very quick to be. I get in my car and I hope for the best, and literally it'll be two streets away from my house, and there's already somebody's already done something. I'm like, can't we just get along? I mean, I not to go back to a Rodney King reference, but God rest his soul. L.A. did get along for a few weeks. After that, you weren't living here yet.
No.
During the earthquake too, it's like anytime there's a disaster, we get along great.
People come together.
Yeah, it's like a 72-hour window. Then we go, oh, that's right, we don't like each other. I forgot. let's go back to it.
What's a competitive town too? You know, everybody's kind of trying to reach their goals.
And they say that, you know, the top 1-2% of their small communities around the country, around the world, come to LA to make it. And then they're here with all of the other top 1-2% of the communities that tried to make it. And now there's a real struggle going on. And I find that the thing that wins the most, and fearful, is nepotism. In LA, people can work as hard as they want, but if they have a son or a niece that even has a skill close to yours, I think they're going to get the job. Yeah. And if I was in the position, I think I might make it easier for my offspring as well to do that. But that's the hard part of LA too, is that you think that just because you have talent, you're going to get something. Often isn't the case. You have to have dedication, perseverance, and be able to be slapped in the face over and over and over, saying, you're wrong, you're not the right one, you're absolutely wrong
for this. That's been an interesting thing, yeah, going to all the auditions. It does kind of, it forces you to do some inward work.
Building. Yeah, because you need to give yourself a pep talk almost every
day.
Well,
yeah, I mean, some areas we feel like we're pretty strong in, but yet you really learn the areas that you're not.
Mm. Yeah, and there are a few, you know, that I'm not as strong in. And
not
I
myself.
Feel bad that I've been in L.A. 30 years and I don't speak Spanish fluently. Mm. That's stupid. You know, I took Spanish in high school and I worked
Me
in
too.
Restaurants for a while, and I should be very fluent in Spanish because there are enough people here to speak it, and I'm not, and that's stupid. So I've made a goal for myself that by age 50, which is only 2 years and a month away, that I will be somewhat fluent in Spanish.
All right.
And if not, no problema. I have until 51. No,
right.
No, I hope that that's my goal. That way I can communicate with more people in Los Angeles, because it does make a difference and it gives you more opportunities for jobs.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm supposed to go to, fortunately, Brazil, which is a whole other language. You know, I don't, I'm not going to speak Portuguese probably as well as Spanish, but it's for a fitness product. But I do a lot of traveling for fitness products and helping trainers and instructors and physical therapists. But it'd be better if I knew the language. Like when I went to Japan, I knew a little Japanese, but I had to have an interpreter, and it loses the connection.
Sure.
So I want a better connection with my Los Angeles, co-Los Angelines.
You will.
Linians, I will. But talking about, finish up the talk about this book, what made you decide to create this one? Because this is more personal, like you said, and this is a lot more work than the list, I would think.
Yeah. You know, everything I've done is just kind of, I just follow my intuitive hits, and I'm still working on it. But I mean, there's a part of me that feels like I was maybe put here, I don't want to sound egotistical, just help others on a fairly good sized scale. And
it's selfless, it's not any.
Well, right. Yeah. But you know, so it's just part of the process for me, you know, myself finding my own voice, becoming comfortable in front of folks, sharing personal stories with others. Because, you know, if I'm not doing that, then it's not really helping anybody, myself or them.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
So I'm just trying to put positive stuff out there, trying to share my journey to help other people along their journeys, and you know, and just put a smile on their faces with the, you know, some of the shorts or a lump in their throat or
right.
whatever
or
comes
or
along, whatever their experience they're supposed to have with it.
When you brought back some memories for me, like when I was reading things and reading in Brian's list as well, that things that I forgot, that we took for granted that we had, and we get, you know, we get so, like you said, jaded and darkened by the efforts we have to put in sometimes in this town that you forget about the small, simple things. And I try to go out of my way to say hello to people all the time when I go places, but I still get so frustrated and so irked when I'm just ignored by the person, whether it's male, female, and whether you know, I'm not trying to sell them anything, but do you ever have that feeling where you're just well, why are you deflating my happiness towards you?
No, I hear you. I go hike 3 or 4 times a week at Fryman Canyon, and it's amazing. About half the people just look straight ahead or look down. And
in nature.
I mean, I came from Oregon where, you know, people, you know, it's just, I don't know, this, it's a big city, I guess. But in nature, too, yes.
Yeah, but I mean, it's in nature. It's not as if there's a bunch of distractions of cars.
No.
And that, I feel that when someone says, like, you walk by me and say hi, and you say hi, there's a warmth, there's an energy exchange that helps me hike better. But when they don't, my head goes down.
Yeah.
I go, why would you want to do that to yourself and to me? I mean, that simple just gesture of and I find the people in the city that do that, they're the ones that become the ones that are prey, because if you don't look someone in the eye, you kind of anger someone that might be a little insecure even about who they are as a person. And just acknowledging people, because I was, my father, who's passed away now, taught me this very important lesson, is that whenever you're out and about, whoever the biggest, nastiest, meanest looking person is, you address them. You say hello to them. Introduce yourself to them. Never avoid their eyes. Never do anything, because it puts you into the position of, I'm prey. Go ahead and attack me. I'm not going to. But when you look them right in the eye and you say, what's going on? They're like, oh, you must have some confidence here that I got to make sure that I get a piece of myself.
It's interesting.
Yeah. And it's been the same thing in just about every category. You as soon as the most important person you say hello to, everyone else sees that you're talking to that person. All of a sudden, they've seen a different person in you. All right, we're listening to Donna Summer here. This is Donna Summer. I want you to turn this up a little bit, because Donna Summer also, God rest her soul, is no longer here, but this came out about 3 years ago. She went into a little blues thing. There we go.
we go.
It's called Slide Over Backwards.
Yes.
We'll listen to this for a few seconds before we go to commercial. We're going to be coming right back with G. Brian Benson to finish up our discussion, and we're going to talk a little bit about Fit in Seconds when we come back from the commercial. And I thank you for joining us here on LA Talk Live for See It Clearly.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Do you or does someone you know have sickle cell disease? Have you heard about the EPIC study? It's an international research study evaluating an investigational drug aimed at shortening the duration of painful crisis. And with over 50 sites in the U.S., there may be a site near you. To learn more and to find out if the EPIC study is right for you, visit www.theepicstudy.com.
NOMA, the National Organization of Minority Architects Youth Summer Camp, consists of field trips to iconic architectural complexes. Join us for 3 days of hands-on building design learning experiences. To register, go to SoCalNOMA.org. That's SoCalNOMA.org.
I lost 4.5 inches on my weight. I went down 2 loops on my belt. I've lost 10 pounds.
Hi, I'm Michael Carson, America's fitness coach, here to teach you how to burn body fat with every meal in only seconds a day. Fit in Seconds is a video workout program designed to accelerate your metabolism, resulting in burning fat with every meal. My Fit in Seconds video workouts will train your metabolism to use food as fuel, not as storage.
With Fit in Seconds, I lost 27 pounds and 5 inches off my waistline.
It's time to get fit in seconds.
Welcome back to See It Clearly. We're here with G. Brian Benson.
Hello.
Hello, hello. And you just heard a commercial about Fit in Seconds. And I'm the creator of Fit in Seconds, and just want to make sure that we give Brian some information about this as well as
yes,
the listening audience. Well, what it is I've been working in fitness for a long time. And to get the results that you want to get without having to utilize all of your day and all of your energy and make it so when you and I were athletes, we'd break down eventually. You know, we would have some overtraining times.
Mm-hmm.
No matter how gifted you are as an athlete, people do get injured. Look at Bo Jackson even back when.
I overtrained all the time.
Yeah, it was something that we almost did it because you have to find out what your threshold is. But I'm not an ultra-endurance athlete anymore, but I do like to compete in smaller things like the mud runs and a 5K or 10K run every once in a while. But to keep myself in peak shape, I found this system called Fit in Seconds. And what it is a workout that you do when you're hungry. You have to be hungry to make it actually happen.
Wow.
And when you're hungry, you have a chemical reaction in your body that changes your body, that focuses you for hunting for food.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we hunt for food by going to the supermarket or going to the restaurant or to the refrigerator or lunchbox, whatever that where we know food is. But we used to have to hunt and gather for that. And so we would be hungry. We would hunt and gather, doing a quick mobility, capture or gather something to eat and immediately eat it.
Mm-hmm.
And it gave our body this survival note that said, okay, you were hungry, you moved, and you ate immediately. So I'm going to make sure that you are able to build those muscles you just used so you'll be better to hunt in the future. And in fact, we're going to make it so you don't eat as much because you could be hunted by some prey that's going to be preying on you as you eat. So the Fit in Seconds system is very simple. You just do it 1, 2, 3 times a day if you don't want to exercise at all. But if you are someone like you and I that works out maybe once or twice a week. I teach a class on Saturdays, and I'm just starting to add one more day a week of lifting some weights starting this week and next week. But you can do this as an exercise supplement, just like you and I take vitamins to increase our supplemental levels in our body. This is something that you would do to get rid of your fat.
Mm.
And people, that's why they're in the gym. They want to look leaner. They want to look more trim. as much as we're told by our doctors, we want to have less cholesterol and lower blood pressure and we want to feel better. It's all about looks. You know, when it comes down to it, can I get in my dress? Can I close my buttons? Can I my belt loop? Feeling good is going to come from all of that, of course. So Fit in Seconds gives you an opportunity to lose between 1 and 3 ounces of fat every single meal or snack whenever you want. And that way you don't have to work so hard. But just wanted to share that with you and the audience because it's something that's going to take a little bit of education for people because they want to work out really hard. They want to work out for long, long periods of time because they want to be able to tell somebody too. I mean, you and I,
we'll do the same thing over and over and over.
Exactly. And
which I now fall into sometimes.
Yeah, and you find that you get sometimes the same feeling that you had, but you don't get the same result as you did because our bodies start to adapt and get better at doing that one thing. And you know, it's great in people that you see, and I've seen them, and I know you have, that are our age or older, we're in our late 40s, that have these knee braces on and that are running, and they've not stopped running since they were in college because they don't know what will happen if they stop. There's no other thing that will make me feel the way I do. I'm not going to be able to stay thin, but they're overusing and breaking things down that make it so they'll never get the goal that they used to have. So for people like that, you know, because I'm sure you give motivational coaching for the triathlon trainings for that as well. What do you suggest to people to start?
Oh, gosh. You know, I really don't do a whole lot of the athletic training, but everybody's different. It just depends on where they're at, you know, what they're bringing to the table. You know what I mean? Maybe where they're at weight-wise, where they're at currently with their lifestyle, you know, what they eat, et cetera. And so you just kind of got to take each person and start with where they're at and then just start working toward the goals, you know, because some people can handle more at the start than others, and some are already maybe eating a certain way.
And that's the thing is that you bring up that's so important is food, and that is more personal to people than any exercise will ever be. And to get them to not eat the foods that are bad for them and to change those patterns, I think that's the hardest thing to get people to do. I mean, it's for me, it's been with my clientele the hardest thing.
You know, for me, now that I'm not really training like I used to, I just go to the gym now and I hike a lot. But energy is the most important thing for me now. And so I've just noticed, and as we do get older, I think our bodies don't handle junk food as well as it might have, you know, used to.
Yeah.
So I need to eat cleaner and cleaner because that's what truly gives me the energy that I want and need. Yeah. You know, the exercise is just kind of almost like an icing on the cake. It's hard to explain, but they work. You have to do both, but
yeah, you wouldn't put really bad fuel in your car and go racing it. You know, you'd want to put the high octane in, and that's what the good foods will do for us. And people out there that, you know, it's sometimes overwhelming to think of changing what you do eat. But if you change just breakfast, start with breakfast even. You know, try to make it so you're eating something healthy. Like for me, for breakfast, I like to make sure that there's some sort of a fruit involved or vegetable, like you do a lot of the juicing as well. But I have protein and I have some carbohydrates. I have some waffles with sunflower seed butter and some chicken. And you know, people go, I can have chicken for breakfast. But the thing is that I treat my body like I am using it as fuel. Food is fuel.
Sure.
Food isn't just to make us have a wonderful taste on our tongue and dance around and really inflame our system with sugars. That's the one other thing that Fit in Seconds will do, not to digress, but when you do the Fit in Seconds workouts and then eat, all of the sugars that go into your blood go into your muscle tissue instead, are sucked in there to be used for energy. So it's a useful and proven way to stop and reverse type 2 diabetes. There's been several studies done, one that just came out that shows that 2 minutes a week of doing 90% of your maximal ability 30 minutes before meals will make it so you actually reverse type 2 diabetes. And mine takes it to another level where it's 15 minutes before the meal and you do it 2 to 3 times a day as opposed to twice a week. So you just completely become an athlete without even having to work out hard.
Wow.
So it's one of those things where in the winter months, people in the East Coast where I'm from will give me all sorts of excuses why they can't do this, why they can't eat that, why they're not going to be fit. And I'm trying to eliminate all of those excuses. And I think that's kind of what you do too, is eliminating excuses for not following your dreams, not taking it to the next level. I mean,
if there's a will, there's a way. That's kind of what I've always thought.
And there's a path. And you chose a path that wasn't just, I have a goal. You took you built a ladder.
I have intentions. I really kind of let go of my goals a while ago because sometimes some of them were a little bit narrow, and if I didn't reach them, I would be disappointed from the expectations that that didn't come to fruition. And so Yeah. I mean, yeah, sometimes I'll have specific goals, like, you know, I'm working on this play or what have you. But for the most part, I just have intentions, and which gives me this humongous, I mean, the sky's the limit on maybe how to reach him instead of before, where it's very narrow. You know, I only get, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. And so. I think that and even doing some of the things that you did, taking the classes and being part of organizations, that opens up your mind, too, because you realize I'm somewhat of an introvert, too. I'm always in front of people doing things, but I'm an introvert. I like to be home. I need to touch base.
Regenerate,
and,
yeah.
Yeah. But when you have that ability to regenerate without having to recoil all the time. Because I'm finding that I have to be on more now than I did in the past because I'm running out of time. You know, how much longer am I going to be young and spry and a viable part of the fitness community?
Two more years.
Just it. No, you're probably right because
I have one.
You know, all these new kids are coming up. Fortunately, they're all tattoos. They look much older than they are. So it's like, you know, they look scarier, and I'm hoping the tattoo thing. Do you have a lot of tattoos?
It's kind of funny. I actually have some. They're all kind of hidden, though. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, see, that's different. They mean something to you, though, right?
Yeah. 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 One's from the Iron Man's, and you know, yeah. Yeah.
See that. I didn't get to try out for Olympic track and field. I wanted to. I just the way it was going in high school, it just wasn't going to work out. If I make it to Masters track and field, and I compete, and I even make it to the trials, I will get an Olympic rings on my ankle or something like that, or wherever the manly places to put it these days, who knows. Forehead. Yeah, on my nose, who knows. You know, Mike Tyson opened up a whole new world for us, putting it on your face and neck. And but yeah, so you haven't, do you have the Iron Man logo?
Yeah kind of. It's there's a way that it's kind of the logo where it's spelled out, like, mm-hmm. I think it's,
yeah, with the I and the,
well, I think that the God, Iron, the M is like red and everything else is like navy, but yeah, Iron Man. So yes, and underneath that or above it, I have a symbol of each race I did in the year. So
see,
I have two maple
purposeful.
Or what's the Canadian leaf, the,
oh yeah, yeah, the maple leaf,
yeah. And then for the one up in the Vine Man up in Northern California, I have a little wine grapes. And then for Phoenix, I have a cactus.
That is cool.
Yeah.
See, you know, I mean, I've, the reason it's in my head is I was someplace yesterday and saw a bunch of people with sleeves, and I normally don't check out the sleeves, but I was checking them out, and there's a bunch of nonsense, you know, like a baby, and you know, in a weird. I mean, maybe it meant something to them, but it looked like it was a bunch of odd things that were just all swirled together to create a sleeve. And I do know a person that got two sleeves in a weekend.
Oh my!
In their late 40s. And it's like, wow. All of a sudden, they went from...
That's like a lot of work.
That's a lot of work, a lot of pain. But I do also have another client, an Italian guy. He got one on his forearm that is so cool and classy looking that I almost considered getting one, but I've just been not... See, that makes sense. If I had some event...
It's just on my hip. Nobody else can really see it.
Yeah,
you know?
But still, well, but, you know, if you...
I forget it that it's there, actually.
Yeah, well, and when you're in a relationship that's, you know, it's... That's something that they'll come upon, and it's like, what is that? I was branded by some tense people. Yeah.
That's another story.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, do you have any aspirations to do any more racing of any kind, or?
You know, no, not really. I did so many races. You know, I did, I think, over 50 races.
That's a lot.
And I'm just really happy and, you know, fulfilled just writing and acting and seeing where that all leads.
Would you help some people train for it, though?
Because
I love still training. I don't want to race. I don't want that jittery day of the race feeling, you know?
I will be, like, maybe an accountability partner, but I really have no desire to help someone train. It's just not what I want to do now.
I bless you for that because...
I'm being honest.
I keep telling myself I want to help people, and then I try and help them, and they're never going to do it the way that... Well, I don't know. Some people are self-motivated, but the people that are just kind of motivated, you can't help them. You know, because it's like you're pulling them through their own training.
Yeah.
It's like, well, that's not good. They're not going to finish.
And I probably didn't train as... I trained really hard, but I mean as smart as I could have. I mean, when I was younger, you know, you recover quicker, and yeah. I could just hammer all the time. And some of the pros were training a ton, and there wasn't the studies being done of how important rest was and stuff. And so
yeah. Rest was not...
I overdid it a lot.
Was not, and carbo loading was the big thing.
Yep.
You know.
Yep.
What do we got here? Oh, we're at the end. This is the song Fever with Jimmy Smith and Kenny Burrell. You could pull this up a bit. I can talk over this as we finish. Well, Brian,
Michael.
Brian Benson is your website. Brian to me, Brian Benson. the G, can we say what the G stands for?
Gary.
Gary.
Yes.
So if you run into Brian and you want to go under the wire, say, hey, Gary.
I probably won't even look because I've never been called that before. You know,
aren't it's you Gary's son?
Yeah,
they'll say that.
Yes, I am.
Why, yes, I am. So once again, www.gbrianbenson.com. You know, I think I'd like to have you back in the fall if you wouldn't
love
mind.
Love to, yeah.
And talk more about what you're in now that your other projects will be released as well.
Sure.
And I think it should be great. I see eye to eye with you, and I've learned a lot today.
Ah, thank you.
I appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure being here.
Thank you much. And next week we're going to have Bonnie Brennan. Bonnie Brennan was a up-and-coming comedian, and she decided to get married and have a baby. And she was working with all the top comedians you can imagine of the day in the 80s and 90s. And now she's come back, and she's about a year back into her comeback. And she's going to come on the show, and she's a really good look at mothering from a perspective of someone who is not afraid to tell us.
She's probably going to use a lot of that for material, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, she's, yeah, and some of it's pretty dark.
Okay.
So we'll see how blue she works. But thank you again for coming in.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you for listening. You're listening to See It Clearly. We're here every week, 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. Pacific, and we'll see you next week. Thanks again.
Choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.